You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
Welcome to yet another wine-packed edition of Two Guys and a Lot of Wine. I'm your host, Bobby P.
And I'm James Kimbrough. And joining us tonight is our guest, Tony Russo, from Supercellar's Wine House on Route 44 in Avon. Tony, so good to have you on our show tonight.
Yeah, thanks, guys, for having me here. This is going to be fun.
Oh, it's going to be very fun, especially since we'll be talking about Italian wines.
Yeah.
Now, as our audience knows, Bob and I are big advocates of going to lots and lots of wine tastings. And, Tony, I've been coming to Supercellar's for over 12 years, and I just wanted to thank you right here for introducing me to so many great wines over the years.
So this is my fault, huh?
Absolutely. This hobby has become an obsession, really.
Jim has come in with his notebook for, like you said, 12 years now. He takes notes and he keeps the labels, which is great.
So you're still lugging that around with you.
I got four or five of them now.
So it's all about the wine.
It is, and we've talked about Italian wines briefly in previous shows. And I love Italian wines, though I haven't had as wide of a range of experience with Italian wines as I have, say, French, California, and even some South African. So I'm actually very excited about what we're going to be tasting tonight and off hearing some of what you have to say about it.
Yeah, I think sometimes people are a little gun-shy about Italian wines because it usually doesn't tell you what's on the label. You know, like California, if it says Merlot, you know it's Merlot. If it says Chardonnay, it's Chardonnay. A lot of times in Italy, they'll name the wines on the label from the region that they come from. Not the grape, so you don't really know what you're drinking unless you know.
And you've actually traveled to Italy.
I did, about 8 years ago. Went on a 10-day trip to Italy, 2,000 miles on a bus up and down the whole country. It was fabulous.
And what regions were you visiting?
Just about all the regions. Tonight I brought two wines from Sardinia, which unfortunately we did not get to the island of Sardinia. Someday I want to get there.
Well, that would require a whole separate boat trip, wouldn't it?
Yeah, that would. Yeah, you can't take a bus to Sardinia.
And yet that's another opportunity to come on the show with some different types of wines.
Yeah. So I did. I got an education and drinking wine from sunup till sundown on the trip to Italy, and it was fabulous. So
well, that sounds like a perfect trip vacation.
It was. I have pictures to remember, yes, so I can remember where I was.
And just culturally, I think it must have been fascinating to experience the food and the wine.
Italians, I'm Italian. You know, my mom started me drinking wine when I was about 2.5. So drinking wine for a lot of years. Italians love their food and their wine combination, and that's, to me, the best way to enjoy wine is to have it with some nice food.
Well, that's always been my impression, is that the Italians create wines to go specifically with food, whereas, you know, if you're drinking a California Cab, that's usually meant to be consumed on its own.
Yeah.
Although you can do great food pairings with those. With the Italians, you have to have something to eat with the wine to truly appreciate it.
Yes, I agree. Yep.
And unfortunately, we don't have a nice big pasta dish to share with you on today's episode. But you can imagine.
We can send out for pizza. Can we do that? Can we send out for pizza? No.
Well, that's actually what's great about Italian wines. I mean, they go good with pretty much any type of saucy or pasta type meal. But I'm actually, like I said, excited about some of the white that you brought.
The wine I brought in the middle here, we'll get to that later, but that's a medium bodied wine that'll work with a red sauce or a pizza. Hard cheeses, and the last wine is a Barolo, which is a rich, intense, full-bodied wine, and that's more for a hearty meal, you know, lamb, steaks.
But we're going to start with the white tonight.
We're going to start with the white, yeah.
And this is from Sardinia? So
this is from Sardinia. This is one of my favorite hot weather, summertime drinking wines on the back deck or at the beach. at the pool, wherever you want to go, wherever it's hot outside, this wine is perfect. So like I say, it comes from Sardinia.
If you want to just hold that up for a few seconds to the camera. So
this is from a winery called Argiolis, and this is a grape called Vermentino. And again, it comes from the island of Sardinia. Beaches, wine, they have the second highest concentration in the world of centurions, people that live to be 100 years old. So it may have something to do with the wine.
I actually think it does have something to do with the wine.
To the wine and the salt air and the, I don't know. So, salute.
Right. Salute. Salute.
So Vermentino from the island of Sardinia. It's a great alternative to Pinot Grigio or Chardonnay.
It has a lot more body than a Pinot Grigio.
Yeah, a lot more lively, more fruit, you know, really jumps in your mouth. And
I get some honeysuckle off of this.
Mm-hmm. Not as citrusy as, say, a Sauvignon Blanc.
So no, there's a little bitter to it, but certainly not a huge
citrus component.
They say you
can taste a little bit of the saltiness in the wine from the salt there. These vineyard sites are 10 miles or even closer to the ocean, some of them.
That's actually a good point. I've heard that about other Italian wines, because you do get the ocean breeze with all that
breeze,
salt.
Yep.
The terroir, I believe it's called. Definitely.
Taste it.
I've been waiting to use
your
that
new
word,
favorite
by
word.
My new favorite word. I'm sure I'm pronouncing it wrong. I said
terroir.
And that is the characteristic and the personality of the soil that the grape actually grows in. So, and I'm sensing a lot of personality in this one. Yeah. So
doesn't see any oak, no oak treatment whatsoever, just stainless steel and then into the bottle.
Yeah, I don't taste
any. Crisp and clean, refreshing. Yeah, doesn't have that flabby feeling in your mouth like a Chardonnay can because of the oak.
And it's got a great finish, too.
It does.
It doesn't fade away at all. It kind of stays with you. It's subtle, but I really like the finish on this one.
And as we've talked about, my favorite thing to do is look at the legs on any type of wine. And there are some legs on this.
Mm-hmm. It's got some body.
It sure does.
Great with grilled shrimp, salads, cold pasta dishes, tuna fish sandwich.
And what's the pricing on this, roughly?
This wine sells in our store for under $15 a bottle.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And where were you exposed first to this wine? When you traveled or back here in the States?
I get tasted on so many wines. I am the wine manager at Supercellar, so I have the a good part of my job is I get to taste a lot of wines.
Sometimes even at
9 o'clock, 10 o'clock in the morning. All my sales guys are trying to sell me their wine. So that's, I think, how I got introduced to this Vermentino was... my salesperson came around and tasted me on it, and I liked it. And so we actually carry two Vermentinos in our store. Both fabulous, but we brought this one tonight from Argiolis Winery.
It's not a common varietal. You don't hear about the Vermentino grape very often.
No, most people have not heard of it. You know, most people that are going to have Italian white, Pinot Grigio. They're going to have Pinot Grigio.
Do you know is the Vermentino grown anywhere else other than Sardinia?
Oh, yeah, it is. It's grown in other places, in Italy, in Spain, California. Just trying a little bit, but it really flourishes, I think, on the island of Sardinia.
Yeah, sometimes you hear a wine varietal and you don't recognize it, and it turns out it's only grown in one little teeny spot on the earth.
Mm-hmm.
So it's nice to hear this has a little bit more dispersal around the planet.
And is that true in Italy as it is in France? You have a lot of very small family-run vineyards, so you have a lot of distinct or individual wineries there that you might not even be familiar with here in the States, that you have a chance to try some really small...
Some small things. Yeah, when we were on our wine trip of Italy, a lot of family-run operations. You know, the father makes the wine, the son is helping him, learning the trade, the mother runs the tasting room, the daughters are cooking. So it's kind of a neat thing like that, yeah.
It's a little family operation.
Phenomenal. Yeah, a family operation, exactly. Yeah.
I'm very jealous.
Yeah.
But this was a great white, and we'll probably come back to tasting this one later in the show, because... Okay. I'm still enjoying the finish on that one.
Very refreshing. Really livens up your mouth and cleanses your palate for the next wine even.
And I'm assuming that this should be not super cold when you serve it, more just chilled.
Exactly, yeah. I have it chilled, obviously, but left it out here for 15, 20 minutes and coming up to a little warmer temperature. But yeah, I think the temperature is perfect, yeah.
And I think that's an important point to make for our viewers also who are still becoming accustomed to wine. Generally, a white like this shouldn't be super cold out of the fridge.
Some people overchill their whites. Mm-hmm. A lot of people do, and that's fine if that's the way you like it, but it kind of kills the taste of the grape that the taste you should be getting from the grape.
Yeah, I have a wine refrigerator at home, which I keep around 46 to 48 degrees Fahrenheit, which is about 10 degrees warmer than your regular refrigerator. So if you're throwing a bottle of white in your regular refrigerator, that's going to get it much too cold.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, thumbs up on this one.
I'm giving this one a thumbs up. I really enjoyed it.
Glad you guys like it.
So we probably wouldn't give you a thumbs down, because I'm sure you have some good stuff here.
Try not to bring bad line.
We want to have you back on the show at some point.
Try not to bring bad line here.
We have a friend of mine who's suggested two wines that I've actually had on the show. One was a complete disaster that was probably best served as swill to one of your worst enemies. And the second one actually was a little bit better. I think that was the uppercut.
I believe we liked that one.
And the uppercut actually was good. So he's 50-50.
Your friend redeemed himself.
He did redeem himself. And I'm sure we're not going to have that problem with
Tony. So Tony, tell us a little about the second wine you've got.
So the next wine, also from the island of Sardinia. This is one of our best-selling Italian wines. I love recommending this wine to people in the store. Again, most people have not heard of this grape. It's a grape called Cannonau. Can we zoom in on that,
maybe?
Yeah,
just hold up for a few seconds. Yep.
Now, you said that's actually a grape that we drink a lot. We just call it by a different name.
Right. It's Grenache.
Okay.
Or in Spain, Grenache.
Now, I did a little reading before the show and actually found out you mentioned that this has the island of Sardinia has the highest concentration of centurions,
mm-hmm.
or second highest concentration of centurions in the world.
After Japan. Yeah.
They attribute a lot of that to this particular grape varietal.
Oh, really? Okay.
Which they oftentimes refer to as Vino Nero.
This is a medium-bodied wine. You can tell by the color. It's
absolutely
not a full-bodied wine. We'll be getting to the full-bodied wine next. But this is a medium-bodied red. It's a wonderful nose. I would almost call it rustic. It's very...
I was going to say some kind of old leather.
Yeah. But in a good way.
Mm-hmm.
Leather in a good way.
I've tasted gunpowder in a wine before, and that was in a good way, too. So.
Very subtle with the first sip, but it definitely opens up.
Yeah, definitely. Yep. Get a lot of floral in the nose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which it surprises me for a red like this.
Mm-hmm.
I was expecting a lot of tannin, a lot of oak.
This is so smooth. A great pasta wine. I always recommend this wine to people when they're looking for something different or looking for an Italian wine, or if they're going to an Italian restaurant up the street, that's a BYOB from our store. People come in looking for wine. I always move them to this one. And pretty much they always come back and buy more.
And what other type of varietal from what other country might you compare that to if you were trying to tell somebody, well, this is the Italian version, what would be something that would be...
Well, again, Cannonau is Grenache, but you know, Grenache in Australia is going to taste different than this. It ripens much more, more fuller-bodied. Grenache in the Rhone region, maybe that would be the closest to this, because in the Rhone region you get that rustic smell and that rustic taste from Grenache also. Yeah.
As this lingers, I'm getting kind of a smoky aftertaste to it. I'm really enjoying that.
It's really neat wine. I love turning people on to this wine.
And can this be cellared for any length of time? Could this, or does this have to be drank
for
5 or 6 years?
This is an 07. This is the current release that we're getting from our distributors is 07. So, you know, it's 5 years old. I think it's delicious right now. It'll last a few years in the cellar, but this is not a wine you want to put down for 10 years. No.
Okay, it's important to know, because if you buy a lot of it and you like it and you want to maybe save one for a special occasion, maybe 10 to 15 years in the basement's not a good idea.
Not for this wine, no.
Well, we talked before the show, before we started taping, about just a general rule of thumb for cellaring wine, and you were kind of mentioning that you could sort of guide that by the price point
of the wine. By the price point, yeah. If you're buying a $10 wine, you don't want to put it away for 10 years. It's going to be worthless 10 years down the road. So you could, as a general guideline, I think, you can go by price point as far as cellaring wines.
That's a neat little trick.
Yeah.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
I actually did not know that. I thought you can still cellar some things under $20.
Well, you can. Like everything in wine, just when you think you got it, you don't, because there's always exceptions and, just this is cut and dry. No, it's not.
I remember a few years ago, Jim, I think I thought I hit the pay dirt because my wife's parents were cleaning out some stuff and there were wine bottles from the 80s that they had. Unfortunately, they were kept on top of the refrigerator for all that time. So,
was it the radiator?
It was the radiator. So a 1983 bottle of, I can't remember what the vineyard was, pretty much was just vinegar.
And it was also a white.
It was a white. But there was one red, too.
I wouldn't store it that long.
Yes.
I have a bottle of Boone's Farm in my cellar that I've been storing since I was 18. But
I think Boone's Farm is still good, though. I think there's something in Boone's Farm that
you
lasts
can drink Boone's Farm forever. Yeah, it's the formaldehyde in Boone's Farm.
You've just lost all credibility. Yeah.
In retrospect, my first wine experience was Boone's Farm. Now, that goes back to the 80s, so you got to cut me a little slack on that.
All right, Tony, we're down to our third wine.
Okay.
If you want to tell us briefly about this one. We're leaving the island of Sardinia now. We're going back to
Sardinia. We're going to Piedmont, which really I think was my favorite region on my wine trip of Italy. Hills, beautiful, just hills that go straight up, vineyard sites that go straight up to the sky. So this is the cream of the crop from Piedmont, a wine called Barolo. Now, Barolo is the region that the wine comes from. It's made from a grape called Nebbiolo. So this is one of those Italian wines that, if you see it, you might think Barolo is the grape. It's not. It's the region okay. the wine comes from. Nowhere on the bottle does it say Nebbiolo. You would just have to know that or look it up. If someone should ask you what wine makes Barolo, it's Nebbiolo grape.
And the Barbarescos are also the Nebbiolo grape.
Barbarescos, again, is a region that the wine comes from and is also made by the Nebbiolo grape. Yeah.
Just a quick question for you, Tony. I know we discussed this previously when I had a chance to talk to you. The label on this one has some stamps on it and the other ones don't. Does that mean anything in the Italian lingo when it comes to wine at all?
No, there's a... I don't think so. It doesn't mean a sign of quality.
It doesn't?
No, I don't think so.
So I've noticed when I shop for Italian wines, some of them have that particular stamp or seal. Mm-hmm. Others do not. But
sometimes you can look at the importer. This is a Mark de Grazia selection. Fabulous importer. I don't think I've ever had a bad bottle of wine from this importer. So you can look at the back of the label sometimes, and that'll give you a hint as to the quality of the wine, too. So this is a more fuller-bodied wine now, obviously the most fuller-bodied wine we're having here tonight.
I'm sure the camera can pick up this is a darker one than
So we're on to the real thing here, yeah, Barolo.
This is
fabulous.
Look at the legs on
that.
This is what you want to have with, a lamb, grilled lamb or leg of lamb, veal, big, nice thick veal chop or a steak or a really nice dish of pasta. This is for Saturday night or Sunday. This is a Saturday night or Sunday wine, not a Tuesday night wine.
You know where I feel this one? On the sides of my mouth.
That's where I'm getting it.
Yeah, too. Right on the sides.
And a little on the roof of my mouth.
Wow.
So this wine screams for food.
Yeah,
totally,
it does.
Yeah,
it does.
Just, I agree with this. Just dried up my mouth totally. Yeah.
That is fascinating.
Yeah.
How that, I mean, the first white we drank, or red, was great. Completely different palate experience as compared to this one. It's amazing, absolutely amazing.
Yeah, a lot of times when you drink a wine like that, you experience some kind of astringent taste where it's almost, a sharp, moisture-sucking activity going on in your mouth.
Yeah, just sucks the moisture out of your mouth. That's the tannin.
Yeah, this isn't that sharp, it's just, but it is drying my mouth out.
Mm-hmm. And did we discuss the price point on this one?
This one would sell for under $60 in our store.
Oh,
so again, we're not talking about a Tuesday night wine.
Right.
We're talking about a special wine that you would have.
Bob and I try to stick
nice
to wines that are below $20 for this show, but every once in a while we sneak in something really special.
You didn't tell me that.
Well, no, I was hoping you would sneak in something really special.
We didn't want to scare the viewers for our first year. You know, we wanted to at least get through 8 or 9 shows where people can maybe, who aren't familiar with wine, to try something that they're comfortable with spending. But this is a classic example of spending more, you get more.
Right.
And
yeah.
If you've been drinking or tasting with us over the last many shows, I think this is a classic example where I'm just going to say the intellectual complexity of this wine has its own mind.
You just make that up?
Yeah, you did.
He did.
I'm going to say this
can do that.
Is well worth the price of the bottle.
Yeah. And again, if we were sitting down to a meal and having this wine, it would really, really kick in. But it's delicious right now.
So if you were to go back to Italy, having been there and toured some vineyards in the past, are there any that you would recommend today?
The vineyards?
Yeah.
Well,
or just regions in general.
Regions, boy, they were all good. You know, we went to Tuscany, all the way up to Venice, the Veneto region. In the Veneto region, there's a wine called Amarone, which is expensive. There's no such thing as a $15, $20 bottle of Amarone. Amarone is $40 and more for the most part, and it can go up to hundreds of dollars a bottle. But that was one of my favorite wines that we had in Italy, and one of my favorite regions was the Veneto region and Piedmont. Like I said, I loved Piedmont. The last night we were there, they put us in their cellar, and this table that went about 40 feet and sat about 30, 40 people, and they gave us this glorious dinner on this beautiful white linen tablecloth, and just kept bringing wine. And we had Barolo and Barbaresco.
So actually,
any Brunello? Those are the killer bees that Italians are famous
well,
for.
Well, no, Piedmont, the Brunello di Montalcino is a Tuscan wine.
That's a little farther south.
So yeah, that's from Tuscany. So we didn't have any, that was like, foreign to them.
So that whole Italian culture, you were right there a part of that communal food and the
absolutely,
wine.
Absolutely, yeah. The owner sat down with us, and it was all about the food and wine and good times. Yeah.
You know, speaking of good times, this wine is still, like, it's still tasting.
Mm-hmm.
You
know, yeah. It's still going on. Yeah. That's what you get from a wine like that. Yeah.
And once again, like you said before, when you get into a wine that is higher in price, I think that's what you're actually paying for.
Mm-hmm.
The experience that at least I'm having with this wine is there's a lot more going on my palate, on the inside of my mouth. And to complement something like that with food would probably be unbelievable. Mm-hmm. I mean, whether it's a piece of red meat.
Can we incorporate food into the next show, you think?
Well, you know, we've tried.
I think people want to see us eating, probably.
We need a chef.
I think the crunching might bother the microphones a little bit. But.
Now, to go back to your earlier rule of thumb that we kind of made up before the show about price versus cellar time, this is a much more expensive wine. How long would you put this in the cellar
for? This is a 2005, so you know, we're talking, 7 years old now. The wine's tasting great now.
Yep.
This wine will go on for another 10 years. Yeah.
So you'd advise, you know, you could drink it today or you could keep cellaring it for another 10 years.
But and again, the only problem, I have friends who have cellars, pulled wine from my cellar, and if you age it too long, you blew it. A lot of times people age wines too long, so I prefer to drink them sooner than later.
Even if you're storing it at a good temperature,
I've had so many wines that with friends, whatever, that just they save them for too long.
So
my advice is drink them sooner than later.
And that's such a shame because you build so much expectation into the evening thinking, oh, I've stored this wine for the last 8 years, 10 years, and let's
and then again, if you age it properly and you drink the wine at its premium, if the wine does age 10, 15, 20 years, whatever, and you drink it at that point, it'll just blow you away.
Yeah.
It'll be like, wow, okay, this is perfect. So again, wine rules never apply 100%.
Well, you hear about people buying wine at auction every once in a while, wines that have been stored away for 50 years, 60 years, sometimes 100 years, and paying thousands and thousands of dollars for those wines, and they don't even know what they're getting. It could be corked, it could have gone past its prime.
The advantage of being a millionaire. I think people just get those as trophy wines to show off.
Well, I think that's true. I think a lot of people that are going to spend that kind of money on wine, aren't going to drink it.
Yeah.
And to me, I don't mind buying wine and storing it, but if I'm buying wine, I'm going to eventually drink it. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to pass it on to the next generation. That generation is me.
Yeah.
Drink me now. Yeah.
I'd be interested to go back to the white champ to see if it tastes different after having
after the reds? Sure. All right.
We can do that right in the show.
We can do whatever we want. Drinking all night.
Okay.
And actually, that's another question I wanted to ask you, Tony. I don't know if we ever covered this before, but you said you have to do some tastings early in the morning. I would think an early morning tasting, the palate might be a little different than tasting something later in the day.
Yeah, they say your palate is the best the first thing in the morning.
Really?
But most of the time I just had a coffee or brushed my teeth or had orange juice or something, so that's not always true. Chewing gum is the worst thing. I'd be chewing gum during the day, and someone will come in with a wine, and it's okay, you spit your gum out, and then you taste the wine. So you got to have some crackers or bread on hand to get rid of that gum.
Carry some wine crackers with you.
And funny story, I actually took a friend of mine to a wine tasting event years ago down at the Mohegan Sun. And he kept saying to me, he says, Tone, all these wines taste like cinnamon. I look at him, and he's chewing gum. He's chewing cinnamon gum. I said, Shay, you got to get rid of the gum. So never chew gum in a wine tasting
event. That's a great tasting tip for our audience at home.
Yeah. That's a sure sign of a... I don't know what the hell I'm doing. Kind of guy.
Have you ever had the opportunity to go to one of those big tastings like at the casino or something like that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we get invites for that kind of thing all the time.
So, is that just something that you would recommend to a novice or somebody should
definitely have? To a novice. Being in the business, it gets a little hectic. If you want to learn about wine and taste a lot of different wines, definitely go to wine tasting events. We do a lot of wine tasting events at our store and a lot of wine dinners, a lot of fun events.
Well, I was going to mention that earlier. Your store goes above and beyond the call of duty when it comes to wine tastings. Yeah, and most stores typically just do a tasting on a Saturday afternoon, whereas you're doing things on Wednesday nights, Thursday nights. You sponsor trips.
Mm-hmm. Yep, we have a lot of fun with wine. Wine is fun, and we make it fun. We try to make it fun for our customers, yeah.
And I think we should also cover with Tony about the new laws that just been passed. Is that going to affect you as to how you're going to be marketing things or structuring anything? Can you actually do wine tastings now on Sunday?
I don't see why you can't. The whole Sunday thing remains to be seen. I don't have too much to say about it. It's really just a mystery.
Yeah, well, we'll see. We're one week into this, so
opened yesterday for the first time, so we'll see about the whole Sunday thing. Who knows?
Now, the another thing we were going to play with on the show here was talking about wine storage. And a lot of people, you know, if they don't finish the bottle, they'll just take a cork, stick it in the top, and say, okay, I have stored my wine. And you leave a lot of oxygen in there.
Yeah, oxygen, you know, air kills the wine. So we sell the pump at our store, as most shops probably do.
It looks like a rubber cork, and it just goes right into the glass.
Yeah,
just
a rubber cork, and you just pump the air out of it. That's all. Just give it about 10 pumps or so until you can't pump it anymore. And that's okay, providing you're going to drink the wine in the next couple of days. Any longer than that.
White actually lasts a little bit longer than a red, correct? In their
You put it in the fridge. I mean, you can. I know people that put reds in the fridge to kind of keep them preserved a little bit more, too. I've had winemakers tell me that they don't really like this. It takes away from their wine because you're sucking the air out of it. I think the best way is to have a half a bottle, you know, a half-size bottle, a 375 milliliter, and whatever you don't finish, put that in that bottle and cork it. Because especially if you have more than a half a bottle left, you're not going to have any air in the wine.
Okay.
So I think that works.
All right.
Well, in the remaining few minutes of the show, are there any other trips you're planning, Tony, to experience more different types of wine?
Always. I always go to California. California is so easy to get to, and there's so much wine there. if you like wine and you've never been to California, to the wineries, you have to go. It's a no-brainer.
So the reputation is justly deserved.
Oh, yeah, yeah. California, the central part of the state where Paso Robles is, and actually north of Santa Barbara up to Paso Robles, is a great wine region. It's beautiful. That's where the movie Sideways was filmed, if you saw Sideways.
We've talked about that movie.
I love that movie.
Yeah,
I'd recommend that to everybody.
Beautiful countryside, the wineries.
Bottle Shock, too, I think, was on our list of movies.
Great
wine
movie.
Sonoma and Napa, if you get up that far, it's all good. Monterey, it's beautiful. There's wineries in the Monterey area. Get to California, by all means,
Do it. And you don't even have to leave the country. You can just, just drive.
Yeah, Italy's nice, but it's a little bit longer trip. Or France, wherever you're going to go.
I think that's what's great about the wine industry now, what's changed over the last 20 years even, that there are so many great types of wine to try right here in the country, especially, obviously, California. And
the wineries here in Connecticut are fun. Wine's not going to be the quality of California, obviously, but fun to go visit the wineries in Connecticut.
Yeah, we've recommended the Connecticut Wine Trail on previous editions of this show, and I say it's a great date. You know, pack a picnic lunch and then go see the state.
Yep. Well, speaking of a great date, I think the three of us are going to have a great date after this show.
Going to get some food and
it's been absolutely fantastic having the opportunity to meet you.
Yeah. And thanks for having me, guys.
Oh, awesome. Thank you, Tony.
Yeah.
And as usual, thanks for joining us tonight. I'm Bobby P.
And I'm James Kimbrough.
And until next time,
keep us in your wine cellar.